Hello and welcome to this CodeBuddies.org live coding session. CodeBuddies is a global community of amazing people who help each other become better at software development through conversations on Slack and peer-to-peer organized study groups and virtual hangouts. Today we're going to be continuing working on the online registration site that we've been building in previous sessions. Took a little bit of a break off stream to develop out some of the features and have a basic working registration form and form components. The code is available on GitHub. You can check us out. I'll update the GitHub address really quick. It's actually changed, but the address is here. There we go. Let me just get that back on screen. A little bit out of practice here. Been away from the stream for a little bit. Anyway, thanks for your patience. I've been doing a decent amount of research about how to build a dynamic form, and I've taken a serious look at, you know, fully reactive front-end frameworks like Vue, lighter weight alternatives like Light DOM. There's another plugin, another package called Intercooler, JavaScript.js, which relies on Ajax to do things on server side and render returned HTML. And each of them have their own trade-offs and their own sort of templating languages or approaches, at least, how they interpolate data into templates, for example. To the, what extent JavaScript is needed to manage the data or the template state. So in a nutshell, I'd like the most of the data and state to be kept in HTML, rendered on the server side, and just a little bit of dynamic showing and hiding. Nothing really elaborate. So for these reasons, I'm just gonna use jQuery, and maybe not even jQuery. I think a lot of this can be done with just plain JavaScript, vanilla JavaScript. So we'll see if jQuery is absolutely useful here. So that's that. Let's go ahead and take a look at the website and the form right now. Whoops, make sure the server's running. And we have this register form. Boom, right here. Not too fancy so far, but it's programmatically generated. The code is it's model driven, so the structure of the database sort of is the primary source everything extends from, and is automatically generated from in the case of these form elements. What we're going to be looking at is how this age field can control either the visibility or the options allowed for various other form elements. And I'll take that pattern, I'll repeat it on a couple of other form elements we'll be adding at a later date, particularly whether or not people need overnight accommodations, and many people will just commute. They'll go to and from the event, but not stay overnight. So we'll have a toggle for that. A couple of other things. For example, if they are just attending one meeting one day, they won't need overnight accommodations. So that Boolean checkbox could actually just show or hide this. It might be a good place to start, in fact. In any case, I'm not sure exactly what's the best way to approach it. So under the registration model, I realized that these accommodations are actually not quite right. These are the types of accommodations people can choose from during the event: camping, dorm, or semi-private. But if I log in, little bit of nuance to it. So the fee structure, there's actually accommodations and there's prices, and they're defined separately for the accommodation fees. The accommodation fee takes an age range and an accommodation type and has a price for either the full week or if they're just coming for a few days, they'll pay a little bit higher rate, but they can select the exact days. Not everybody can attend. It's a week-long event, and some people have to work during the summer and can only attend the weekend days, for example, so we want to be pretty flexible and accommodate those needs. So yeah, we will try to do this with just plain JavaScript first and jQuery as needed, and then more complicated and novel and popular, so to speak, options as required. But I really want to keep this project simple and use sort of unexciting technologies. To meet the basic requirements of having a dynamic form. So the first thing we can do is I'll actually hide my video here. And we'll do a couple of experiments with the JavaScript console down here. You see, we've already got jQuery available, so why not just get more mileage out of it and use it? In fact, I might have just answered the question for myself, but what is... what is this being used for on the front end? To be honest, I can't think what it's used for. Let me check one thing, see if I can debug this message. I think there's an import ordering issue I need to load jQuery before I load the bootstrap material. And I also just want to check my pull request that this sprint 4 is the one that's in progress. It looks good. Yeah, so I'm putting all the commits in the correct branch down here, sprint 4 branch. Just want to do that. So let's see, in the templates directory, we have a base template. And here is where we're including JavaScript at the bottom, jQuery first, then Bootstrap material design. Looks like I'm not including the JavaScript, so that would make sense that this is why I can't load. All right. We've already got the CSS. Here. Let's just go ahead and put it there for good measure. And refresh the page and see if the error goes away now that we've got our JavaScript in place. Yeah, looks like we're good. While I'm here, I'm going to check one thing for this bootstrap material design. I want to display these options rather than as a select menu as radio buttons. Reason for that is I can show and hide the I can change the visibility of radio buttons, but not for select options. I can only disable select options from what I just read. Radio. So I think that looks pretty decent anyway. Great. So what we're going to do is define a radio list, radio options list with this data in the template as data attributes. And I'll use the JavaScript to programmatically toggle the visibility of certain items based on whether or not the age of the registrant falls between the age range that the options are available for. All right. So we're good to go. And yeah, let's just start with that. Now it's going to take a small change to the model. We fixed this. Go ahead and commit that fix. Good. And I think we don't need to work with the base HTML anymore. Now in the model, I made a mistake in our, actually I've not done any of this on the stream, so in the registration, the registrant is a person who's registering for the event and attending it. We're gonna have accommodations options. Let me just see how this is defined. If I scroll down kind of fast, so I think it's actually many to many or overnight accommodations. Here it is. It's a foreign key, but we don't want to actually link it to the accommodation because it's not just the accommodation that's relevant, it's the option that's relevant that has the data about the pricing. So the accommodation fee is what links together an accommodation option and price, and that's at the end of the day what we want people to select. All right, so that was, I think I should be able to fix that pretty, without too much fuss, and just gotta get the name of the accommodations model. So here's accommodations, must be under fees, model, accommodation fee, yeah, it's pretty straightforward. But you can see here the accommodation fee is the same fields, the minimum age and maximum age who are eligible, the accommodation, and weekly and daily fee. So. Now I'll just run this migration. Under fees, so I need to change the app name, plural fees. Overnight accommodations links by a foreign key to fees, accommodation fee, and we want to not delete things cascadingly just in case. We want to keep our data integrity. And how much work I got to do in the front end to make this change reflect. Okay, so yeah, not very much work is needed. Actually, I think at least it'll automatically generate the form with all of the accommodation fees, which I was kind of expecting. But the problem now is that I don't have any data in there. So if I inspect this element, all we have is the, let me just see what we have. For each option, it's we have the internal ID, the database ID, and then the label, which is essentially the accommodation name. So at this point, I can't really rely on the form auto-generating. I'll have to now start overwriting the HTML for all of the fields. We're going to get into a little bit of a challenging situation where we've got essentially this form duplicated. So I'm going to try to share the form logic in both places. We've got a registration page and then a way to manage my registrants. In other words, a person can register their whole family or friends or other people for the event alongside with their own registration and manage those and edit those. I think the editing, it's not an explicit feature that was part of the requirements from what I understand, but I kind of added it in. I think it's a nice thing to have. So, and I'm mid-sprint, so I'll have to get feedback on this code. But in any case, what I'm trying to say is I just want to share the code in one single place. And if we don't want people to edit it, then that makes it easy, but the code will still work. So right now I'm just going to focus on the register form and figure out later how to share the code. I have a basic idea in the back of my mind, but right now just do one thing at a time. So the first thing we'll do is just, commit these changes. Now we'll come to the form HTML. Now there's a couple ways of doing this, basically Python or HTML. So if we look at this HTML approach, we're really able to get this whole form automatically generated and changing for us with one line. It does all of this, the Django forms framework. I like that, but when you need to override it, we have to figure out how to now modify either all of the form fields and just have them to some degree of customizability or somehow in a loop detect the form field and selectively modify one. That might be an approach. I think I'll try that. So let's just check the docs. The other option is, in the form code, the registration form is a model form. You can somehow override widgets there and maybe add data attributes and things like that. Let's just take a look at both of those approaches. How to render a Django form manually using custom HTML attributes might be a good one. And notice I'm on the Simple is Better than Complex blog. Really great resource, excellent resource for all things Django. So this is the looping approach. Let me just see. If I can just define a custom widget, that might be useful here. And I want a radio input. Yeah, man. Well, let's start with that. Let's just toggle the widget, and then I can perhaps create a custom widget. So this is for the accommodations, right? What's the name of the model? Field. Overnight accommodations. So simple start. Let's just toggle the form element. There we go. Now I want to override the HTML to add these attributes on here. The value is not sufficient unless I want to render these options on the server side and pass them in via AJAX, which I can do with intercooler.js. But I'm trying to keep the sort of the rendering logic local to the client and not have to rely on network requests to change the UI state, unless there's something like a price calculation or something else that I don't want to have duplicate code across the network. But for checking these options, it should be data driven, and it should be possible for me to put the data right in the data attributes on HTML. Yeah. Each widget has a template name attribute and the value of such as input.html. Now where would I define this? Well, this is really specific to the Redis. Let me think here. The accommodation. The accommodation fee, but it's also specific to the registration form. So I think I can define the template here. Yeah. As the field name, so it's clear what that is used for. And then I'll need to define the class. I've never done this. A lot of things here I'm not really doing. They're not really familiar with, so. Where do you put this? In a widgets.py, perhaps? Let me see if there's general instructions. I wanted to research this in advance, but it didn't occur to me until live coding. Let's start here. So we just saw Pi, I'll just take a wild guess. Radio select. This is why I want to share this form logic. I guess it'll work. Now if I just put something in that template, what does it do? This is an HTML, so it should give me some love there. Alright, it works. Interesting. Now I just need the HTML. What's the context look like? Need a little bit of tea. So you can override the context. That's consistent. It's a dictionary, huh? We can just take a look at this. Radio.html. I'll just copy it straight up. But let's add one field. I'm just gonna put that in here just so it prints out the price in plain language, plain text. So there it is. Yeah, I know I can put something in the template there, and now it's rendering things correctly. And I can actually then get the option.price, I think it is. If I look at the model. Not that model, but the fees. Model accommodation fee has. Daily and weekly price. We don't really want to put that there. I'm just going to put there for just a moment. So option.daily fee. No, I don't want to do too much guessing here. Somehow I've got to get some insight into what these options are and how to get the properties from them. Honestly, this code is just a bit confusing. This is essentially what I'm trying to do. Catch some data properties. So it takes three layers. You gotta have the radio select and then pass it to a renderer, which passes it to an index. Seems like a bit much, but all right. In this case, I won't need a template though, it seems. All right, let's try it out. But I still don't know what self is. In this case, I guess it's the option. So then I've got this select, radio select. Pretty verbose. updated. All right. Seems like a lot of moving parts. Dang it. Sort of in a deep area that's not very well documented. This is the first time I've had this experience in Django. It's a bit confusing. So I think this option doesn't represent the data. It represents a widget. So that's working. Think it's different if I still have an option here. Oh, let's go. I've got to enrich this with a little extra context. I'm trying to think of, this is totally, trying to think of where to do it. I don't have any clue really how to pass in. There's the get context method, right? And that's the consistent way of doing things. I mean, I can change the widget, but this is actually, I need the data to come out of the database. I can pass in attributes, static attributes, but. I want this field to render in a way, you know, amidst other fields in the form. I could enrich the form page context with like the options that you can select from and render that into a template. That wouldn't be a problem, but I want this to be part of the form and not the form page. The form is rendered in a page, a wagtail page. It seems like this widget is where I need to be working, but I just don't know how to override the widget context. Provide extra data to the options, to each of the options. So this this would be nice if I can just override the init here and add the attributes. But well, this is actually this dictionary. I need the dictionary to come out of the option. So either I need to make a database query here, or the data are right there. I don't know what self is. Let me just print self. See what self looks like. Now, I've tried using the debugger in VS Code. It's been a little bit problematic. Haphazardly close these tabs out. What's the point where it actually has the option in code? I don't understand that. Where this select widget, either the options or the individual option template has the data. Where does the data come from? This is quite confusing. Might just remain a mystery, unfortunately. I'm at over 1 hour and I haven't made any progress on getting this data into the template to the point where I might need to think of a different approach. I kind of wanted to stick close to Django Core. Actually, let me just go back here. Git context is where I need to be taking checking out, isn't it? All right, well, here's at least the option groups are available here. Yeah. So, a couple of things I can do here. This radio select, I should probably just override, not the template name, but the option widget. And define the option widget class. Inside that class, I can check out the git context. And inside of the git context, I can run my database query to get the extra attributes and attach them, return them as attributes. I think that's the way to go. All right, I'm gonna take a short break. Get a little bit of water for tea when I come back with hopefully a fresh mindset. I'll do a couple more searches to see how I can change the option widget for multi-select or radio select or whatever the equivalent is. Override the context, get that back into the template and render it, perhaps without having to write any HTML in this case, as the attributes should just be populated automatically. All right. Well, thanks for sticking with me, and I'll be back in a jiffy. All right, thanks for bearing with me. So I think I've got it. I'm ready to proceed. So I won't need this init function, initialization function. I may need to define the option template, but if I can just pass this as data attributes, that'll automatically get rendered in the option template, good to go. I think that's gonna be possible if I can get into those attributes for each object. Now the thing is, radio select is a composite widget. From what I can tell, it's a widget that has sub-widgets. So let's inspect the code, the source for radio widget. It inherits from choice widget. Choice widget has sub widgets and options and option groups. And here's where I need to get into these attributes. You can pass in attributes. I might not have to get to this level. Here's, I think, where as deep as I want to get is get context. But for each item. So yeah, what I'm trying to look here for is how I specify the class for each item. And then if I can get the context inside of that. This is just a matter of reading and hoping it works out. At the very least, I believe I can do this in the get context for this radio select widget. It won't be as pretty, but basically I can probably override these option groups manually here running the query. I'll just have to construct them the way that it's expecting. I'd rather not do that. Well, let's see if this function, this API still exists in render option. That would be actually good. Usually Django is pretty good about backwards compatibility. All right, this looks more promising. Yeah, okay. Yep, one moment, tea's ready. I think this is about the right level here. In particular, look at these options. Let's go ahead and continue that. Inspect. Label. The value. Oh, dang. Oh, yeah, there it is right there. So if I get the value, I can do a database query for this. To look up the accommodation fee and create two additional or a number of additional attributes that are needed. Yeah, I think this will be all right. It'd be cool if this option was already in context, but it's like being passed in. Not really sure. Probably not doing this in the most ideal manner, but. Just want to try something. All right, so def. And what does it take? Arguments do we need? A whole bunch of them. All right, so let's do this correctly. There we go. And this zeroth one is the placeholder, placeholder. So what we need. Really good. Now let's just see if there's some values there in the terminal. I mean, either way. Actually, I can just see if there's an accommodation. It's going to loop over those, though. So let's see. What did I do wrong here? Okay, so, yep. Pretty close, but pretty far. No air. So I feel like it's pretty far. Really a bummer. this really close, because this is exactly what I'm doing. Django 2. If I just select widget, more or less, radio select. It's not exactly that, but the create option takes these. Arguments, super options. One step at a time. Too much copy and paste errors. All right, there we go. Now I iterate over the options, apparently. Might already have the items available there. That's good to know. All right, let's run this in debugger again. That's what I was hoping for. What have I changed here? Self. Let's check out that source attribute. I didn't notice that one before. This should work. As soon as I try to interact with the database in there. All right. So the query can't fail. I can't query it with the zeroth one, but this should return none. This is probably there. Whoops. Yeah, I'm the whoops already here. Okay, so it's raising an error. Yes. Tea time. So two things now. First, I'll just get these attributes on here, these data attributes. I'm really close there. Then I'll change the title to include the daily and weekly fees so it's transparent when people are making the choice. And I'll call it good. I think if those two things are successful, then I can come back and do the JavaScript stuff later once the data are in the view, in the HTML, then I can do the dynamic stuff. This was more challenging than I expected. But I think this is a pretty Django-esque way to do it, just not very well documented. I had to read through the code, things like that. All right, let's continue though. And thanks to Stack Overflow. So yeah, this is really good. I want this as attributes on the form, yeah. On the op, on the, well, on the form, but on the option. Mm-hmm. So. So, I believe we'll have an attribute here. Where will it be on the LI? The LI is actually where I would probably need it. A little bit, little caveats. Let's see if it even works, right? Yeah, it does work. Well, if I hide it, it's going to be all right. I think it'll... No, the LI will still be there on it. No, I think hiding this should hide the, hiding the input. Won't hide the label. The label will still be there. I'll have to at least hide the parent. I'll figure that out when the JavaScript part comes around. It won't be too bad. It'll be a little kludgy, but now I see how it works. We've got the data in there. That's the key. So let's finish that out. Pardon me. Don't have to do any fiddling with the HTML or anything like that. That's cool. We just want to put a couple more properties on there. Age min, age max, accommodation, no, but full week fee and daily fee. Wow. 2 hours. Add those attributes in there. Those templates now. All right, 3 commits, 2 hours. I'm gonna call it good. In the next session, we'll work on a little bit of JavaScript, maybe with jQuery, maybe just plain JavaScript to show and hide these based on the value entered in the age field and comparing it against the minimum and maximum to only show the appropriate options. So that'll essentially mean either, you know, hiding or removing this li or just hiding the label and everything inside of that. We'll see if the how the showing and removing works. And again, I've looked at, you know, whether or not I should just be doing this in Vue.js or something like that. And I don't want to commit to doing this whole form and the whole front end in a JavaScript framework by any means. I do want to just sprinkle something in. I know Vue.js can progressively enhance pages as well as a couple of other options. But I don't either also want the data to live mainly in JavaScript. I'm trying to the best of my ability to keep the data in Python and then HTML and bring it into JavaScript by interacting with the DOM. I think that's an all right approach for such a problem. I'll see what challenges has come up when we're trying to show and hide these widgets. But I think this should be manageable. There will be a few other dynamic form fields as well. So there will be, I'll be having to write imperative code. I will miss out on the declarative aspects of a nice framework like Vue. But it's just a balance, I think. I've tried to figure out a way of doing this with Vue, and I just couldn't figure it out quite, how to do it without committing to having all the data more or less the JavaScript dynamically generated with the accommodation options in there. And I didn't want to rely on dynamic JavaScript to populate the form fields, when I'd rather to progressively enhance this, show all the data, and then hide the irrelevant HTML elements, the irrelevant DOM elements. I guess there's one more thing I can do and override the string method for the accommodation fee, and which I'm already doing here. F-strings here. Well, let's just see how it looks. The prices on there, it's going to be a long string. Not bad. So we got the age ranges in there and prices. And next session, we'll be able to selectively toggle those. So it'll only show the appropriate age range options, and you'll have the prices listed there as well. Maybe I'll clean it up somehow, make it more easier to compare vertically, while still preserving the ability to select. Well, I don't want to get too complicated. Trying to keep it simple. All right, well, thanks for checking out this live coding session. It's not a tutorial by any means. It's me figuring things out and struggling along the way, learning a lot of interesting stuff. Again, this is part of a Code Buddies live coding session. And Code Buddies just encourages people to learn with one another, show what you're learning, how you're struggling, and offer help to other people who are along their own, a similar learning journey. So I hope these live coding sessions have been useful. And if you're interested in helping someone else along their way, stop on by codebuddies.org. Or if you want to get help yourself or collaborate, there's a lot of active coders there. And the codebuddies.org website is under active development on GitHub as well. All right. Thanks again for watching and have a great day.